Please join me in the opening prayer. Gracious God, we come to you this morning in awe of what you are, with love for how you care and with gratitude for what you give. Speak to us this morning and bring us the peace that only you can give. Amen.
Thank you. Our scripture reading for today is found in the book of Psalms, chapter 95, verses 1 through 7. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout out loud for the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountains' peak belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. You know, one of the greatest needs of humankind is the need for companionship, the need for friendship, and the need for community. During the months that we were in lockdown for COVID, I think one of the biggest things that we can remember is the loneliness that we all felt. I can tell you that every Thursday evening, I was looking forward to every Thursday evening when we will come here to record the services for the live stream, or the streaming, not live streaming, but the streaming. And I remember standing in different corners because we were so afraid of getting close to each other, and it will be our check-in time. How are you doing? How's your dog doing, right? Is your plant growing? Any very minute thing that we could share. It was so important for us to share. At least I know it was for me, and I remember with the people who will come, and we will have those moments for checking in and for just connecting. It was 10, 15 minutes, but it felt like a fresh water to our souls. So as human beings, we are made to be connected, to live in community. That's why friendships are so important. And that is something that is just in us. Our Creator put it in our hearts. And Psalm 95 is one of my favorite psalms because it talks about that communal act of worship. So if you look at the title of the sermon, What, Why, and How, it kind of doesn't relate to either the psalm or the anthem that we heard, Heaven in Our Minds. But I walk with me for a little bit and we'll see how everything connects. So what is worship? Worship is where you put your heart and you give value to something or someone, and you decide that that something or someone is of such value that you're gonna pour your heart towards it. That is worship. So in our culture, in a postmodern world, many people will say, well, I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual, so I don't worship anything. But the truth of the matter is that we all worship something, okay? And it doesn't have to be a God, but we all worship something because we all put our heart towards a goal, towards something that is of meaning and of importance for us. Whether it's financial success, social stability, emotional stability. If our main goal is to have good relationships, that becomes the object of our worship. So worship can do something to you. It can either destroy you, or it can change and transform your heart. And the more you do it, the better you get at it. So that is what? What is worship? It's where you put your heart. Now, why do we put our heart in something? Is that something that we choose to do? As I opened the conversation today, is we are made for community, and our heart desires to place itself somewhere. So that's why we need that. We need an object that we give ourselves towards. And that object, according to Psalm 95, is God. God is our God. See, the psalmist doesn't talk about my God. He always talks in the plural. He always refers to our God for we are his people. And in including that communal language, David is including every single human. It is not just the ones that meet at this particular building at this particular hour. He is a God for everybody. So that is the why. And now, how? That we got to the how. How do we worship? And that is when it becomes a little bit tricky, because worship is one of the most debatable subjects, at least in the religious world, in the Christian world, because everybody seems to think that they know how to do it. And my how is always better than your how, right? But I want to submit a different idea today to you. What if the form is not as important as the result? Worship can either destroy you or transform you. So if the end goal of worship is to let God transform our hearts and use us, then the form is not important anymore. Because we can either worship here, or we can worship under a tree, or we can worship while we work, we can worship while we talk to our friends, or while we're walking our dog. We can worship in many different ways. And the how becomes one of the best things that we can experience, because it will bring joy to our hearts, real joy to our hearts. One of the, if we talk about the United Church of Christ, there is one phrase that always comes almost actually after the name, United Church of Christ. And we say, God is still speaking. I love that, because it turns our community into a community of action, a community that serves a God who is alive, who is not just found in a book, but it's alive through all of us, and he still speaks through us. So when we worship him, when we worship God, we can do it so many different ways, not only through song and through music, but also through action, because the act of worship involves everything, our mind, our will, and our emotions. So I wanted to do a short inventory. I know we do a lot of community service. One of the things that drew me the most to First Church was the willingness and the ability of the community to serve others. And in a way, to put ourselves second, right? Because here is not about me, but it's about what I can give to someone else. So let's see, how do we use our mind in service to others? When you go and analyze and see what are the needs of our community, what areas need my attention? And yesterday I was having a conversation with a new friend. For a long time, for 23 years, she was a math and science teacher. And a year and a half ago, she started suffering from epilepsy. There is no reason for it. But now, because of her seizures that are unpredictable, she doesn't have a trigger, she doesn't know when they're coming, they just come, she is no longer able to teach. And that was one of her passions. That's how she felt God called her to serve others, being a teacher. So she's trying to discover how to use her gifts now to serve others. But at the same time, in conversations, I discovered that because of her situation, she is not eligible to be considered disabled. Because under the law, her mental abilities are still intact. So she could use her mental abilities even if she was in her house all day long, because she's not able to drive. So I was thinking, is this a way of God telling me, maybe this is something that you need to look into, and that is a way of worship as well, helping people that fall under the through the cracks, and we are not aware that they're suffering and they need our help. So one of the things that I admire the most about this community is that ability to look through those cracks and find the people who need our help. How do we use our will to worship? You know, one of the, as Americans, right, one of the most valued treasures we have is our freedom. Our freedom to choose, our freedom to do. And telling someone to say, you have to submit your will to someone else is something that we don't like to hear, right? And we don't want to say to anyone because we don't want to offend anyone because freedom is something that cannot be taken away by anyone. But when you decide and it's your choice to use your will to serve others, then it becomes very powerful because it is a choice. Nobody's asking you to do it. Nobody's telling you you have to do it. And you don't do it because you feel that you're gonna win something. As for many years, we thought that if we were good, if we were doing A, B, and C, we will earn some kind of reward at the end. And we know that that is not the case because grace is given to us freely. We don't have to work for it. But when we decide to use our will and our mind to serve others, then we can find peace and joy in the service. And then the last one is our emotions. Emotions are sometimes a little bit tricky, and we have learned as adults, right, to control our emotions. If you're angry, you don't show it. If you're impatient, please try to be patient. And those are good qualities to have, right, to have our emotions under control. But God is also calling us to worship God with our emotions. And when we serve others, when you feel that compassion for someone, when you can sit next to someone and listen to their story and cry with them and feel what they are going through, that makes you more useful because now you are at the same level as the people who need that help and you can relate to them and you can help. We all can do that. So you see, as we have these three dimensions of worship, our mind in worship, our will in worship, and our emotions in worship, we are worshiping God as we serve others. So Psalm 95, for me, becomes then a guide of service. Because if we say we worship God and it doesn't result in a transformed life, then we are not really worshiping. So this morning, think about God still speaking. And God is. I would like to invite you just to think today. Are you letting God speak through you every day in everything you do? And with every person that you meet, through every circumstance that you go through on your daily life. Maybe today is a good day to let God speak through us. Amen. Now, as we remember that God is the giver of everything, we have many ways in which we can share our gifts. We talked about how we can share our gifts with everybody, but we can also share our financial gifts through different ways. So you can do it. There's some codes on the front pews, so you can just snap a picture, you can give that, or you can drop your donation in the back box as well. And we appreciate all of those donations because they help our church to keep reaching out to others. Now, I have some joys and concerns that I received today. And I have Pastor Jill Terpstra asked for prayers for her best friend, Elizabeth, who's having major surgery this week due to cancer. We also have prayers for Carol Dankers, for her friend Marianne, who she literally knows from the day since the day she was born, and she recently entered palliative care, her friend Marianne. We also have Melissa and Rick Hennessy. Prayer of celebration for Betty Meyer. This week, she turns 94 years old on Thursday, and she is my birthday partner. We share a birthday, so happy birthday to Betty, 94, big celebration. I also have the names of those who fell victim of violence this week in our city. And we might not know them personally, and their names might not mean much to us, but they are important to someone. And right now that someone is suffering and is hurting because they lost a loved one. So when we read the names of those who have fallen, we are honoring their memory, and we are also feeling with those who are feeling right now. Portia Dixon, Anthony Jackson, Kenneth Douglas, Devonte Fitzpatrick, Jamal Harris, Tiana Bosley, and Jamika Wright, both age 16. Bryson Roundtree, and three unidentified men. Let's bow our heads. Gracious God, as we come to you with celebration for life, as you give Betty one more year, as we also come bringing worries about our friends who are suffering from illness or who are going through end-of-life care, we ask that you be with them, to be with those who are crying for their loved ones, and because we know that you use us and you are with them even through these difficult circumstances. We also prayed for those who lost their lives to violence, and we pray for the time when pain will be no more, suffering will be no more, and you will wipe away the tears of our eyes. We know that that day is coming, but until that day comes, help us to live lives that will honor you, that will worship you, and that will be a blessing to all of those we encounter each day. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, our last, and I skipped the prayer song, I'm sorry. Maybe we can sing it next week. But we're going to sing our last hymn, My Hope is Built on Nothing Else. Thank you. Now, as we go out of these doors and out into the everyday world, I pray that God may still speak through you every day with everything you say, everything you do, and everything you are. May God bless you. Amen.